All right guys, we are back in my garage for another video, and today we're gonna continue tearing down the blown B58 engine for my 340i. In this video, we are going to be taking a closer look at the cylinder head. So I'm gonna show you guys how to remove the cylinder head, and then we'll take a closer look at the internals so we have an understanding of how it all works, what all the parts are, and just give you a better idea of what's going on under your hood. So let's go ahead and talk about it, and hopefully you guys find this video useful. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. All right, guys, so here it is. This is the B58 cylinder head coming off. As you can see, I've already removed a bunch of stuff, so the cams are out. You don't necessarily need to remove the cams, but you do need to remove all the timing chain stuff in order to get that off. So I just went ahead and removed the cams as well to make it all a little bit easier. But there are 14 bolts, 7 on each side of the cylinder head that need to be removed. And actually, just looking at it, I remembered there's another small bolt right here and one in here that also needs to be removed. So 14 main head bolts plus these two smaller bolts will need to be removed, and then we'll be able to pull off the cylinder head and see if we can tell what went wrong with this engine. Now, that whole breakdown will be in the next video. In this video, we're just going to look at the cylinder head itself. All right, so here it is, the B58 cylinder head, everything removed from the engine block, and basically what you see is what you get. This is pretty standard for a BMW. You know, it's all aluminum. It's got too many cams, too many rockers, but it kind of is what it is. This is a part of the sauce that you get when you sign up for BMW engine tuning. So as we've talked about in previous videos, this is the eccentric shaft. It's an eccentric cam that just controls Valvetronic, and you've got the Valvetronic motor that sticks in the side here, and it has that gear that turns this to adjust how far the cam is actually pushing down on the valves, and that increases or decreases the amount of airflow in replacement of a throttle body. And then of course we've got 4 valves per cylinder, so you can see 4 valve springs, 4 rockers, all of that stuff. It of course has hydraulic lifters, so that's what they look like. Again, nothing too crazy, pretty standard for any modern German car, much less a BMW. So pulled this off just to kind of get an overlay of what's going on here, but I think we've made multiple videos on this with the valve cover removed and doing other PCV things and stuff. So yeah, again, kind of what you see is what you expect. Only other thing I think I haven't touched on is we do have this crankcase vent. So we've got the three head ports on this side that are all tapped. So if you look in there, you can kind of see I've threaded into the holes and blocked them off, so that way no airflow can actually get into the cylinder head through the PCV system through these head ports. But you do have an extra vent on this side. So yeah, everything is pretty much what you would expect here. Then we've got our exhaust ports. So these are all, you know, kind of oval holes. This is where the exhaust gases come out to go into your turbo. And then on the other side, let's turn this around. And then yeah, up here you can see the intake. Again, big oval ports with two valves per cylinder, so it kind of splits down the middle of each port going into the cylinder or into the valves. But yeah, everything is pretty much what we've talked about in other videos. Now we can flip this over, and this is what the inside of your cylinder looks like. So it's probably a little bit weird to see from this angle, but it should be pretty much what you expect. So you've got your spark plugs that stick out in each cylinder, and then right next to it, you've got a hole for your injectors. So literally your fuel is spraying right next to the spark plug, and that is a part of the BMW direct injection strategy so that you get a really efficient burn. But that's also why we need so much fuel pressure, because the fuel is spraying directly into the cylinder, and you can imagine when the cylinder compresses and everything creates that big explosion, you're getting hundreds of PSI inside of your combustion chamber. So you need extra fuel pressure to compensate for that, just to make sure that the fuel sprays effectively. Now around the side, we've got our coolant ports. So those are the ports that actually go through the cylinder walls and then come down into the cylinder head. It goes in on the exhaust side, then flows over to the intake side and comes back out. So that just helps keep the cylinder head temperature more even across the cylinder head by bringing in the cooler coolant on the hotter side where the exhaust is, and then it goes over to the cooler side where the intake is, and now you've got the warmer coolant going down back into the cylinder block and then into your radiators and stuff. I think overall this looks okay. You know, you kind of expect them to be different colors depending on how the air is flowing, but overall I think this doesn't look too bad. Some of these look a little different, like cylinder 6 kind of has a darker exhaust valve, and then cylinder 2 as well also has slightly different valves. But the only way really to know if this is a problem, like if it's a leak or something, is to actually measure it or do like a pressure test to see if air is leaking past those valves. But as is, nothing immediately jumps out at me. I don't see any damage to the valves, but I'll do a deeper look off camera, and if I see anything, of course, I'll add it in here. But yeah, cylinder head 101, you know, again, of course, this needs to be completely flat, making sure that you get a good seal onto the car, and then you've got a gasket between the surface, so that's where you see some of these red witness marks and like leftover residue and stuff. That's from the head gasket sealing it to the cylinder head. If you do have any head gasket issues, then you could get, you know, compression loss between the cylinders, or you could get oil from these oil ports. I don't know if I said that before, but these bigger ports are for oil flow. You could get oil going into your coolant, coolant going into your oil, coolant going into the cylinder and getting burned. So a lot of different things could be potentially happening. Yeah, again, nothing immediately jumps out at me. This is really my first time looking at it all, but I'll take a deeper dive and see if, you know, there's anything else that is a concern to me. Actually, just realized I had these backwards. So this one is cylinder 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then this is the back of the engine, cylinder 6. But yeah, everything else pretty much applies the same way I said it. I do see that this surface looks a little bit more washed out compared to the carbon buildup on like the other cylinders. This one is a lot more shiny. Somebody was also mentioning that the injector hole might be ovaled out or bigger than it should be. I don't have a tool to measure that to know if maybe I was just losing compression through the injector hole. So that could potentially be a drawback as well. But that's why, you know, you should be replacing your injector seals every time you swap these out, because if that gets blown out, then of course that'll cause misfires and low compression and other issues. And if you replace the injector, put a new seal on it, that could potentially bring compression back. So yeah, I think those are all of my initial thoughts. I'll look at it more off camera, and if I see anything, I'll add that to this video. But overall, that's what the cylinder head looks like. Actually, flipping this back over, I just realized we didn't talk about the oiling. So when you have these little holes down here, these are oil ports so that oil can come out and lubricate the cam. So you can imagine the cams are spinning right here, pushing the valves open and closed. And all these little holes are where the oil comes out. And the size of those is critical because they make sure that you get enough oil to lubricate the cams, but also make sure it's not too big where you lose oil pressure and stuff like that. So it's very important that these are sized properly. And then you get oil throughout, you know, basically everything. And then it goes back down through these holes and it drains back into the oil pan. So pretty important that all of this works. Thankfully on the B58, it's not a huge issue. Also one point here, so we've got our high pressure fuel pump mount and that mounts up right here. And as you can see inside, there's also a little hole where oil comes in to lubricate it, because you've got the cam follower that's riding on the cam and pushing up and down on it to create fuel pressure. So that hole also flows oil, and that comes from this little hole, which comes from this little port. So again, I think it's like a very well thought out design. I mean, high pressure fuel systems aren't brand new or anything, but it's still important that all of this works and is safe, especially if you're going to be revving your car up to 7,000 RPM. So I know a lot of people have found out when you delete your high pressure fuel pump, you need to do something with this oil outlet. Otherwise, you can have issues with oil pressure. So yeah, just something to consider. All of the cam ledges have that hole for oil to come out to lubricate the cams, and then oil goes throughout the entire valve train, making sure it's all lubricated, and then drains back down to the oil pan through those ports. So yeah, that pretty much sums it up. And again, in my case, I wasn't really able to identify anything that jumped out at me that could have been causing my low compression issue. So in the next video, we'll be taking a closer look at the actual cylinder block. So we'll take it apart, take a look at the pistons, the rods, the crank, and all of that stuff, and see if anything can help us identify what actually went wrong with my 340i. So stay tuned for that. That video should be coming out soon. Otherwise, I think that's it for this video. So thank you guys for watching, and I hope this helps. And if you have any other questions or comments, leave them down below.